How's it going, guys? Back again this week, and gonna talk more about fishing mindset. I actually found the kind of little manuscript that I used when we were doing the Secrets of Ahi Fishing seminars at POP. So this is from 2019. And I realized that I kind of jumped way into it. I was looking for this and I couldn't find it before I made the last video. So I kind of realized I jumped way ahead of the process. So today I'm gonna answer a couple of questions and we'll probably try and get to through portion one of this manuscript before moving on. So we'll probably go over the working the zone again later on as we get into this. So couple of questions or things that came up from the last video is speed. And again, I like anywhere from 4.5 to 7, 7.5 maxing when the water's really nice. And the reason why I like that is, again, at a slower speed, your white water behind your boat is a lot less crazy. A story you'll hear a lot over time is, in Hawaii anyways, is a lot of times when guys are fighting an ahi, they'll crank, let's say they got a bite on the starboard side and they're fighting the fish off of that side. On the port side corner, they're clear, but the rigger, they'll just crank it up to the swivel, gets to the rigger clip, and they'll let the lure dangle there. And the boat is stopped, and while they're fighting the ahi that they have on the starboard side, another fish will come while the boat is dead stopped and bite the rigger out of the clip on the port side. And then also, if you think about dangler fishing, those guys are probably, granted they're throwing bait in the water, but they're probably only going 2 or 3 knots. And for us, I kind of came up with that, I guess, theory based on that. And then also, before we had the boat that we have now, we had a small boat, an 18 footer. And a lot of times we'd be fishing and it'd be so rough that it, you know, we didn't have a choice but to kind of creep along at 4.5 knots going up sea, or we get pounded to death. And then coming down sea, you know, I'm trying to stay at 7 knots, but every time the wave pushes us from behind and we start surfing down sea, if I'm doing, let's say, 6 knots, when the wave starts pushing me, now I'm doing 10-12 knots, so I just end up backing the boat down to like 4.5, and then as a wave pushes us, then maybe we'd skate and surge up to 8 knots. But most of the time it'd be when we were in that in between the swell and the boat slows down, that's when we would get the bite. So there's that. And then again, you'll hear stories more times than not of, oh, I was fighting with fish and we was out on dead stop and the other side lure bit out on dead stop. More than, you don't hear as many stories of, I was running home, I was late, I was trying to get home. We had a lot of ground to cover, so I was pushing the boat 10-12 knots and the rigger came slamming down. Most times if you're doing, you know, 9, 10, 12 knots trying to get back home, that's gonna be a morning. They just like it at a faster clip. So that's, again, the theory of why I like to fish at a slower speed. I think we'll cover that deeper into the pamphlet here. But when I'm kind of, if I'm in between zones, or I'm going to the zone and I so happen to be actually trolling, I'll probably go 8, 9 knots just because I'm covering ground. But once I get into the area, then I'm varying between 4.5 and 7. And once I get a bite, I kind of take note of the speed and I try and work closer to that speed at that time. So I had a question on Instagram about the birds, so I'll go over that again. A lot of times, when you're fishing for ahis, you're looking for smaller bird piles, and you want them, they're most of the time gonna be kind of popping up here in your marked zone, and then they'll sit down, and then all of a sudden they'll pop up here, and they'll sit down, and then all of a sudden they'll pop up here, and they'll sit down. A lot of times there'll be like a big cluster of birds, and just off to the side there'll be a smaller cluster of birds. Maybe, I don't know, this pile can have choke birds inside, and this pile off to the side, 8 to 15 birds or so. If that scenario comes up, and this is me, I always go to the smaller pile. More fish, you know, the more biomass, I guess, would be mean more birds, and that's probably going to mean ahis. And then, you know, bigger birds potentially, and less birds, and that's where the big ahis are. The other thing, the more specific to that guy's question is, how do you tell the difference? Again, the birds will kind of pop up in the zone. A big ahi pile, like, there could be birds sitting here for hours, and they're kind of waiting for the ahis to come up and bite. But a ahi pile will come through, and there'll be birds in it, and they'll more like be running through the area. And these birds, they don't care what kind of fish it is. They just want to feed. So as this ahi pile moves through, all these birds will stand up and jump into this pile. Now you got this massive pile running through your zone that looks super good, but if you go off and chase it, they're gonna pull you out of your fishing zone. So just to kind of recap that. And then the real question was, kind of what type of lures that do we run going down sea versus going up sea? And this is kind of the question that I want to base, I guess, the rest of this series on, is to help you guys kind of get past these types of questions as much as possible. And kind of that's why we've done videos on lure colors and hook setups and all of that. Is those are pretty much the colors we run every season. Typically I pick my 5 or 6 lures that I'm gonna run based on the information that I'm acquiring, and I do not change my lures the whole day unless we get a bite and it's a good fish and I need to change the leader, put a fresh leader on. I'll probably run a different lure for a while I'm working on re-rigging the lure that just got bit, and then I'll put that lure back out. So most days I'm not changing any styles, any colors, unless for whatever reason, some, you know, we're fishing and the guys, my friends are calling me and saying, hey, I'm getting bites on this color, and for whatever reason I didn't know that leading into it, and I need to change up my spread a little bit, but that almost never happens. So I guess to recap, especially if you're starting out, I like bullets and inverts, and if the water's real nice, I'll run some cut face stuff. The main thing when you're starting out is you don't want to be running a mixed stuff pattern back there, and your cut face stuff is jumping all over the place, and you get a tangle and not know about it. Because a lot of us are fishing smaller boats, and we're trying to pull 5-6 lines, and the wind is blowing and the ocean's rough, and you get a tangle and you're dragging a tangle around for couple hours wondering why you're not getting bit, only to find out later, you know, the reason why. So to keep it simple, I like bullets and inverts, and that's why usually only if it's real nice, I'll run more cut face stuff. But again, I guess the main thing this series is designed to help you guys with is not really thinking about the lures don't catch the ahis. The fishermen catch the ahis. The realistic thing about it is I got friends who catch a lot of ahis on the stuff that we make, and I got friends that catch a lot of stuff on other people's lures, and you know, straight up chrome heads. A lot of the commercial local guys will just run straight up chrome heads because they're consistent and they do the job. So ahis tend to be more color than it does style. So I hope that answers the questions that you guys had from the other video. And so now I'm gonna kind of get into this sheet. And probably if you're starting out in fishing, this will be one of the biggest impacts for you.
Tsutomu, premium big game fishing lures and offshore apparel. Our lures are handcrafted in Hawaii and proven around the world. Discover the beauty of Tsutomu lures and let us help you put more blood in the box. Tsutomu, the Hawaii Fishing Company.
I would say 80% of your fishing efforts should be done the few days leading up to the day that you're actually gonna go. Most of us aren't able to drop everything on a dime and go fishing. So, you know, 2 to 3 days before you go, it's a good idea to start calling around and get an idea of what's happening out there and find out who caught and where they caught, and also find out who didn't catch and where they was, because if you know where they're not, that helps you cut down your coastline. You know, again, the harbor, eel, seal, and even out, if you turn the corner toward the north side, that's a huge area to cover. And what you want to do is shrink this big area down to a small zone. So, you know, back in the day, I would make sure I would call 6, 7, 8 people and get the information, and I would basically put a list in my phone. Jason caught one 10 miles, 30 degrees. JR caught two, 12 at 34. Y'all never catch nothing. You know, Brent caught him 12 at 40. I'll give you one more. Ali got him 12 at 47. Okay. Mark got one 19 at, let's say, 70 degrees. Okay. So, you know, I look at my list and This was 2 days ago. This was 3 days ago. This was yesterday. And these two was yesterday as well. So now I got kind of two zones that I know the fish have been coming up in, and this information is more fresh than this information. Let's just say this guy caught him 3 days ago as well. If you're starting out, you're gonna probably have to call a lot of people. When I started out, I used to call a lot of people and then just whittle this list down and find kind of the constants. Us, you know, for us, the 12 mile range is kind of right around the 1,000 fathom line. So, oh, they must be moving up and down the 1,000 fathom line. It seems like that area between 30 and 50 degrees is the zone. But they might be moving that way. So, you know, if I go here and I don't find them, I might creep into the 20 degrees because it seems like they're moving that way up the coast. And I'll put this information in a little note in my phone so that if the day's not going well, I can kind of look at my phone list and be like, okay, this is the information I got. Let me make my calculations based on the information I got and the things that I see going on in the ocean, rather than just kind of going like, ah, shit, I get on feeling they're going to be over here and jet off into the wild blue yonder, way out of, you know, the little bit more scientific approach of how the fish is moving. So, you know, based off this information, I would pick a zone that's like 10 to 12 miles at 30 degrees, and that would be that 2 to 3 mile radius zone that I was talking about earlier. So yeah, the pre-fishing is where you're gonna get the most work done, because you on one boat, or you and, you know, your friend that's going out on his own boat that day, you can only cover so much ground. You gotta try and shrink that area into a smaller zone and get the intel before you head out, and make a plan before you head out. You know, make a plan the night before you head out, or make a plan that morning when you're driving down to the harbor. So a lot of times I'll have my main spot, and then I'll hopefully have an idea of a secondary spot. And when I'm fishing that day, if I come out here, I'll work this zone for the morning bite, basically, you know, 3 hours or so. If I see something happening here, I'll definitely stay here. This is the freshest, best information that I got. This would probably be the information that's like 2 days old. And so if I come here and it's completely dead, let's say the whales move through or something, and now you walk into this area and there's nothing going on. Now I come over and work this zone. And also read what's going on in the ocean, which way the birds are going and whatnot. But something that I don't do, again, is I don't nowadays come to this zone, find out that it's not happening, and they just chance them and go to BO. But that was just chance of mentality. Not gonna pay off most times. So no good army goes in to a battle without a plan. And also no good army goes into a battle without getting the information first. So I guess that'll be the point of this video, is before you even go out there, pick your lures and any of that, call around, ask your friends. And you know, for us, when I talk to my friends, it's miles and degrees, and then what color, and it doesn't have to be the specific color. It's like they're biting ice blues, or they're biting purples, or they're biting pinks. And then the other one is what time. And then, you know, I figure out what time they got the bite, and then I go straight to the tide chart and I look at the tide. Okay, the thing biting at this point of the tide, and then tomorrow probably gonna bite 1 hour later as the tide changes from day to day. So information is the key to consistently catching fish, because the ocean is really big. You need to shrink it down into a zone, and for that you need to have a crew of guys that you guys all share information with. If you don't have a crew yet, work on it, and over time that crew will get better and better, to the point where you'll know which guys have the good consistent information, and vice versa. When you go, even if you don't catch, and you know, for me, like, you get the information from your friends and you go and you don't catch, and the last thing you want to do is talk to anybody. But call your friends, tell them, hey, I went to that zone, this is what I saw, I never see nothing, or I saw people getting bit, but I personally never got the bite. Make those calls and build and strengthen your network, so that in the future you can call on them again, and over time, getting the intel before you go will pay off. So I hope this video helped you guys. We'll move more into this next week or the week after. And again, if you have questions, send me a message on Instagram or leave it in the comments below, and I'll try and go over it. Have a great day, guys.